Why should people be interested in knot theory? I mean, what are the reasons why people should be interested in knots? Well, knots go way, way back. We were talking about this at the very beginning, actually. So one of the first examples of knots was Alexander the Great and the Gordian knot. And as Alexander said, when Alexander reached Gordium, he was seized with a longing to ascend to the Acropolis, where the palace of Gordius and his son Midas was situated, and to see Gordius's wagon and the knot of the wagon's yoke. Over and above this was a legend about the wagon that anyone who untied the knot of the yoke would rule Asia. The knot was of Cornell bark, and you could not see where it began or ended. And that's going to be crucial to what we're interested in. Alexander was unable to find how to untie the knot, but unwilling to leave it tied in case this caused a disturbance among the masses. Some say that he struck it with his sword, cut the knot, and said it was now untied. But Aristobulus says that he took out the pole pin, a bolt driven right through the pole, holding the knot together, and so removed the yoke from the pole. Okay? For our purposes, the part of this we care about is this part here, and you could not see where it began or ended, because that's what we mean by a mathematical knot, okay? So a mathematical knot means you take a circle, you cut it open, you've got a string, you tie a knot in it, you glue the two loose ends together, as we talked about before, okay? So that's a mathematical knot. You're allowed to move it around in space all you want, but that's how you create a mathematical knot. Incidentally, we're going to come back later to what happens at the molecular level. I want you to think, how would you do this on the molecular level? Okay, that's a hard problem. That's a hard problem that people are very interested in. Okay, so here's a knot. I'd like you to try to make this knot. I wish the green doesn't really show up that well, but hopefully you can see that. This knot here, I want you to make this out of your string and then hold the two ends together. Try to see if you can make this. This is a trefoil knot. It's got three crossings on it, so it crosses itself at three points right there. And see if you can make that knot out of your string. And then once you make it, I want you to decide whether or not the knot that you have created is this one over here or this one over here. Now, you'll notice these two knots at the bottom look very similar, but in fact, they're not. They're actually mirror images of one another. This one is the reverse of the other one. Okay? So this is what's called a left-handed trefoil. And the other one is called a right-handed trefoil. And the question is, the one that you're making at the top, once you make it, which is it? Is it the left-handed trefoil or is it the right-handed trefoil? And you think about that one at the top there, incidentally, you'll notice it's very similar to the way you tie your shoes. When you start tying your shoes, you take the two strands and you do the one over around the other. And that's really what you're doing right there. And then you hold the two loose ends together once you've done that. Very similar. What do you think? You think it, you say it again, you think it's a left? You think it's a left? So at the bottom you can see the two pictures. It actually means that your left hand kind of is spiraling in the way of that knot there if your hand moved along it. But that's a left one, that's a right one. And the crossings are just the reverse of one another between the left and the right. How many people so far say left? Everyone's raising their left hand. Isn't that interesting? How many people say right? Yeah, that's true too. Yeah, it turns out, so I'm going to tell you because I want to keep things moving here. It turns out this is, in fact, a left trefoil. Not obvious it's a left trefoil. Also, what's not obvious is that there's a difference between left and right, okay? But in fact, it turns out there is a left trefoil and a right trefoil, and they are not equivalent. There is no sequence of Reitemeister moves that will ever take you from this one to this one. This is the simplest knot known to humankind, and many people for many years didn't realize there were two of them, that they were actually distinct, that they're really different knots. You have to actually go through some mathematics to prove that. These are what are called chiral knots because they actually have a handedness to them. They have a difference between the left and the right. Okay, so these are chiral knots in the fact. And you remember that other knot that I showed you, the figure eight knot, does not have a difference between its left and its right. You can actually rearrange it to look like the other one. Actually, we'll look at that one right now. Okay, so we're going to move on to the next one. So there's the trivial knot of the unknot at the top. We've talked about there's the trefoil knot, which also has this notation 3 sub 1 is another notation for that. And as we've already said, there's a left-handed one and a right-handed one. This is the figure eight knot. I'm going to show you another picture of it because this isn't a very good one. And I want you to try to make this one. This one's a little bit harder. Notice the difference here. This has 3 places it crosses itself. This one's going to have 4 places. Let's look at a better picture of that one. There's the figure eight knot, 4-1, and it's got 4 places that it crosses itself, there, 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 and there. And that's the simplest picture you will ever make of that knot. There are no pictures of it with fewer than 4 crossings. So see if you can make that one. That one's a little bit trickier. And it actually doesn't matter whether you do this one or its mirror image, because as I said, they're in fact the same knot. There's no difference between it and its mirror image. Okay, and while you're working on that, because I know there's a few people who are looking like, oh, I've already got that one, I'm going to put one more up for the experts, for people who feel like, okay, I'm ready for the next one, and that's 6-3. And this is a six-crossing knot in the tables of knots, a little bit harder. That's the hardest one we'll try at this moment. If you have 6-3, raise your hand. Tell me if somebody's got 6-3. You got 6-3? Oh, look at that. You've even got a special rope for doing it. Did you come with all the knots in there and you just pulled out a 6-3? It's great. Good. Beautiful. Very nice. You got it? Okay. Oh, yeah. No. Looks good. Yeah, great. Beautiful. Yeah. Yeah. So, and imagine trying to do this on the molecular level, okay? You're trying to do it by hand, and it's not easy, right? It's not easy to figure out how to thread the one through the other, but try to do it on the molecular level is going to be a lot harder. Okay? Okay, now I know this is a cruel thing to do, but we are going to move on, okay? So I know you're looking at this picture like, I've almost got it, but we are going to move on, okay? So let's see what happens next. So here is a table of the knots, okay? And I'm not going to ask you to do all those, but you see another picture of 6-3 there. There's the figure 8 there. And the table of knots just goes up and up and up, okay? The ones that have 7s on them have 7 crossings. So 7-1, 7-2, 7-3, 7-4, 7-5, 7-6, 7-7. There's 7 crossing knots. You have 21 8 crossing knots. The numbers just keep going up and up. And so mathematicians are trying to make a list of all the possible knots of some size. So you can actually say, for all these knots here, no one of these knots can ever be rearranged to look like any of the others. They're really distinct knots. They have to be distinct. And so people have been working on making a list of these. Now, one of the things you can do with knots is what's called composition of knots. So we mentioned this before, where you take two knots, you cut them open, and you glue them together. Okay? So that's called a composition. So here I took two trefoil knots, cut them open, and I glued them together. You can get a more complicated knot. And here's a fundamental question. Can you take two non-trivial knots, compose them, and get the trivial knot? That's the question. What do you think? So here's one knot I'm going to make here. Got to do it just right. And Marilyn, can you verify that that's a non-trivial knot, that I'm not cheating? You verified it. Okay, so she proved it. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, now I'm going to take a second knot over here, and I got to do it just right here, through there. And Lauren, if you could just verify that's a non-trivial knot. Does it look good? He believes it.
I don't know if it's trivial or non-trivial.
You could, if I snap that together, you could not disentangle that. It looks like it's really tangled. Does it look good? Okay, good. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to take this non-trivial knot, and we're going to snap them together. And the question is, could I have created an anti-knot? Could I have disentangled the one knot with the other? I've got them together now. Okay? So now I'm going to pull this through here, pull this around like this, pull it through, and... Nope. Sorry. Cannot be done. Okay? Cannot be done. But it took mathematicians a long time to prove that, to be able to prove that rigorously, to prove that you cannot ever succeed in doing that. And that's kind of fundamental. Now, everybody in this room already knew that to a certain extent, right? Because every time you go into your closet and you pull out an extension cord and it's all tangled up, how often do you say, oh, I'll tie another knot in the line and then it'll all, you know, people kind of know this already. So it's not that surprising as it turns out. Okay? But now, you can have a whole theory of knots, just like you can have a theory of prime numbers and composite numbers. You have a prime number, like 7, and a prime knot, and you can have a composite number, a product of prime numbers, and you can have a composite knot. So it mimics the same thing that happens with integers. So we can have that, okay? So we have this for compositions. And so now here we can make this table of knots. This table of knots, now we're getting a little bit longer here. These are the prime knots. We're not bothering with the composite knots. We're just going the prime knots. And then you can try to tabulate all the possibilities. But it's really hard to distinguish between two knots. Somebody hands you two knots. How do you tell whether or not they're the same knot? That's hard unto itself, let alone worrying about all the different possibilities. How do you tell whether or not these two knots are the same? So this was a paper that occurred that came out a while ago due to Jim Hostie, Morrowind, Thistlethwaite, and Jeff Weeks. And the title of the paper is one of my favorite titles of all time, The First 1,701,936 Knots. And it's actually a tabulation of all the knots with 16 crossings in a picture or fewer. And they tabulated this, and it took, I don't know how much computer time in order to do this, but they actually used a computer and a whole lot of techniques. They used hyperbolic geometry. They used a lot of other invariants, algebraic invariants associated to knots, and they made this tabulation. And this is now I don't think I have the date on there now, but it's like 10 years old now. Nobody has done the 17 crossing knots. It's still open, okay, because it's just there's so many of them, and nobody knows exactly what they are. Okay, but let's ask the question, why should you knot? Why should anybody care about knotting? And so I want to talk a little bit about knot theory. First of all, DNA. So DNA is a long, skinny molecule. Everybody knows it has this double helix structure, but it's like taking, people have described it, inside the nucleus of the cell, it's like stuffing 100 kilometers of fishing line into a basketball. So it's hugely messy and all tangled up, not nicely wrapped fishing line, all tangled up inside there. But it has to do transcription, recombination, other things like that. So it turns out that there are enzymes inside the nucleus of the cell that allow the DNA to knot and unknot. Okay? And so these are some pictures of knotted DNA. These are actual electron micrograph pictures of knotted DNA, relatively short knotted DNAs that you see there making various knots, including a trefoil knot and a composition of two trefoil knots. And then you have these enzymes that make a crossing change. So we're going to say the unknotting number of a knot is the least number of crossing changes to turn a knot into the unknot. So here's a knot, 7-4, which you can't see very well, but it's there. And what we're going to do is we're actually going to make this. And so I'm going to need a bunch of volunteers to come up here as we need groups of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I need 8 people over here. I need 8 volunteers. Just come on up. That's fine. 8 volunteers over here. Yep. Okay. And I need another 8 volunteers on this side. Okay. So I get 8 people over there, 8 people over here. Okay, and any extra people, if we have more than 8, that's fine. You can help to direct these people how to do it. Okay, so you can't see it too well, but these green things here are your heads, and they have little protuberances. Those are your noses, which tell which way you face, okay? So we have 2 people at the center, so we're going to make you 2 be the center, and I want you to face back to back. Perfect. I want you to stay right there. I want you to stay right there. I need another volunteer over on this side. Why don't you come on over on this side? You 2 are the end people over here. You guys, I want someone over there to direct them into the same shape I'm directing this into. I need someone to start directing them, okay? Then I need 2 people over here, okay, on this side. You 2, okay, doesn't matter, okay. You 2, okay. Now, look at the red things are your hands, and you want to see whose hands you're holding. Almost every case, it's a left hand going over a right hand, okay? So you guys tell them how to do it. I'm going to help these guys over here. So I need 2 people back to back in the center. You 2 right here. You stay there, and you go to his back. I want you to face him over here. I want you to face him over here. I want you guys over on 2 people on this side. Great, and you face him. Beautiful. Why don't you come on over here, and you stand next to her right there, and then 2 people on this side. Yeah, perfect. Great. Okay. Then what I want you to do is most of the time your left hand goes over and your right hand goes under. Over. Under, over, under. I think you guys are great. Don't move. Great. Let's see how the guys are doing on the other side. Don't go anywhere, okay? Hey, how are we doing over here? You got it? Okay. So we have 2 knots here now. This is going to be very exciting. We have 2 knots here. Now, if I were a cruel person, I'd say, ready, set, go. You have to try to untangle without letting go, right? That'd be a very cruel thing to do because it wouldn't work. This is a non-trivial knot, okay? But on the other hand, this knot has an unknotting number of 2. Which means if you change 2 crossings, you can turn this into the trivial knot. And the 2 crossings you change are the central crossing and 1 other crossing. So don't do anything yet, okay? Nobody do anything yet. I'm going to change the middle crossing. So just let go for a second. Go under there, beautiful, to there. And then I'm also going to change this crossing, okay? Now you guys stay there. Don't do anything yet, okay? Now we're going to go to the other side, and we're going to change the same 2 crossings over here. This is going to be a good battle here. Youth versus Not quite as young, yes. Okay, so we're going to change the Central Crossing to there. And then we're going to go that one. Okay, is everyone ready? Now, when I say go, I want you to, without letting go hands, I want you to try to disentangle. Don't go yet. Don't go yet. Okay, ready? On your mark, get set, go.
Go over.
Good. I would step over those hands right there. You step over those two hands. Keep going, just ignore them. Keep going, guys. You're doing good. Oops. Good, good, good. Good. Oh, now you're doing it. Good. Keep going, guys. Great, great, great. You got it. Keep going. Good job. Whoops.
Jump.
Okay, I got my arms
off. Keep going. Yeah, go through. Go through the hole. Go under the arm. Go under the arm. There you go. Go under. Turn around to your back. Whoop. Hang on now. Yep. And flip your arm around. That's it. Yep. Turn around. There you go. Good job. Good job, guys. Good job. Excellent. Now, the minute you have a circular molecule, you can't help but say to yourself, wait a minute, couldn't I cut that molecule open, tie a knot in it, and glue the ends together and get a completely different substance? Even though it's made of the same constituent atoms bonded in exactly the same order, now I've got a completely new substance. It used to be an oil, and now it's behaving like a gel. It's behaving completely differently. And then I say to myself, then you say to yourself, wait a minute, didn't you say there are over 1,700,000 different knots of 16 or fewer crossings? That means with one molecule, cyclic molecule, long enough, if we could figure out how to knot it, we could get 1,700,000 different substances from that single molecule that we started with. Synthetic chemists are salivating all over the place here. I mean, they are so excited about this. This is one of the first examples of a knotted molecule. So they started when they were building, this was, I think, 2001. They took a couple of pieces like this, they put them together in the right way, and they actually generated a knotted molecule. So this is an example of a knotted molecule. What they'd like to do is get better at figuring out how to make these knotted molecules in order to be able to create all these new substances. So people are very excited about that. So when you model a molecule, when you do it with chemistry, you always think of the bonds as being sticks, straight sticks. And so you might ask the question, you have a stick knot, you might ask the question, well, how many sticks does it take to make a given knot? So we'll just finish up with that because I realize it's starting to get late. So how many sticks does it take to make a non-trivial knot? So that's a very interesting question, right? How many sticks do you think it takes to make a non-trivial knot? I could start with 3 sticks. You think 3 sticks is enough to make a non-trivial knot? No, because it'll always make a triangle, and a triangle doesn't have any crossings, it's not going to be knotted, right? So a triangle's never going to be a non-trivial knot. So 3 sticks isn't enough. How about 4 sticks? What would a picture with 4 sticks look like? Could be a square, right? But it could also be, with 4 sticks, you could have a square or a bow tie, right? That's all you're going to get. And a bow tie is only going to have 1 crossing, you could untwist it. That's not enough crossings to get a non-trivial knot. So 4 sticks is not enough. What about 5 sticks? Do you think 5 sticks is enough to make a non-trivial knot? 5? Okay, good news. Everybody here, I believe everybody here, has 5 sticks on them right now. Namely, your upper arm, your lower arm, a stick across your shoulders, this arm, this part of your arm, this part of your arm. That's 5 sticks. You were born with 5 sticks, typically. Okay? Can you clasp your hands together to make a non-trivial knot? I don't know what the insurance issues are here, so don't hurt yourself if you can avoid it. Is there a way to clasp your hands in a non-trivial way to get? And the thing is, I mean, a lot of the time you think, well, maybe now I've gotten, but then you look, oh, gee, look, it's a trivial knot. I can still disentangle it, so it's actually still a trivial knot. So it turns out it doesn't look like 5 is going to be enough. You might say, well, I'm just not flexible, but in fact, it turns out 5 is not enough. Now, I'm going to prove for you 5 is not enough using this stick right here. Okay, and this is one of my favorite proofs in all of mathematics, and it's a very simple proof. Imagine I had a 5-stick knot, okay? And this is one of the sticks, and there's 4 other sticks hanging off it here, okay? So you have to imagine the 4 other sticks. You really have to think about that for a second. Here's one of the sticks, and because it's bent a little bit, I have to make sure it's straight, okay? Imagine you look straight down that one stick, and you drew a picture of what you saw when you looked straight down that one stick, keeping in mind there are these 4 other sticks hanging off it, okay? So I look down. this one stick, what am I going to see when I look down one of my five sticks? What does the one stick look like when I look straight down it? Looks like a point, right? And then, so what am I going to see? What am I going to be left with when I draw the picture of my knot, when I look straight down this one stick? Four sticks. I'll only see four sticks, in which case I'm going to see that picture right there, right? Or just a square. It's still going to be a trivial knot. Doesn't that seem like the worst cheat you've ever heard in your life? You know, you just look down one stick and then it's not there anymore, and therefore there's four, and therefore can't be a... But that's the argument. That is a valid mathematical argument for the fact that five sticks is not enough, okay? So five sticks, as we said, with a person is not enough. Well, so six sticks. Do you think six sticks are enough? Who thinks six sticks are enough? Okay, come on up. Come on up. Have a volunteer, okay? So good news. You have the five sticks you were born with. Come on over here, and you can face the audience. And this is your sixth stick. Can you make a non-trivial knot with the sticks that you have that you were born with, plus the one extra stick? And if you want, I can hold it for you, help you, if you while you're trying to figure out. So you want to tangle up your arm somehow. You were doing it before. That's good. I like it. Oh, I like it a lot, actually. I'm going to help you a little bit. I'm going to, don't hold it yet. Let me slide it through this hole right here.
Okay.
Now hold on there and try to keep your wrist pretty straight. And this is the hard part. Bend that around there. Ladies and gentlemen, a six-stick trefoil knot. Thank you very much. Good job. Very good job. That's a six-stick trefoil. Okay, so it turns out that you can actually, here, she's going to get a picture of you right there. That's a six-stick. Unfortunately, I can't untangle him, so he's going to have to go home that way. So, very good. Thank you very much. Good job. Thanks. So it turns out that you need at least six sticks to make a non-trivial knot. What if I compose two knots, like a trefoil with a trefoil? How many sticks do you think? It took six to make one. I compose it. How many does it take? 12? Yeah, 12 is a good guess, right? If it takes six to make one, you put them together, 12. You think I can do any better than that? 10? Remarkable fact. I found this shocking. The students and I actually proved this. 8. Six to make one and only two extra sticks to make another whole part, but it turns out that it works. You can actually do that. In fact, you can take, this is small, was our summer thing, this was done with students, the stick number of n trefoils all glued together turns out to be 4 plus 2n. In other words, every time you add another trefoil, you only have to add two sticks onto it. Very surprising fact that that would be the case, but it turns out to be the case. So that's kind of interesting. I'm going to skip a slide or two here. Those are all torus knots. Don't worry about that. We're going to skip this. Okay, what's left to do? What are some questions that people don't know the answer to? Knot theory is rife with questions that people don't know the answer to, some of which I find embarrassing that we don't know the answer to these. Number one, these are what are called the two-braid knots. So they're just two strands braided around each other, 5 crossings, 7 crossings, 9 crossings. Find the stick number. We do not know the stick number for these knots. We can't prove, we have conjectures as to what it is, we can't prove that you couldn't do better. For just simple sequence of knots, we don't know the stick numbers for those. Very embarrassing, right? Aliens are going to come and visit Earth and they're going to say, what do you mean you don't know that? What's wrong with you people? I told you that I knew what the composition of all those trefoils was. Change one trefoil into a figure eight at the beginning, I don't know the stick number anymore. Nobody knows the stick number anymore. Nobody's been able to figure out what the stick number for that is. The hard part is not getting a bound. You can construct. Once you construct it out of sticks, you know you can make it with that number of sticks. But how do you prove you couldn't do it with one less? That's the hard part, is proving you can't do it with any less. Okay? And then it turns out there's still 8, 9, and 10 crossing knots that we don't know the stick number for. So those questions are still open to a certain extent. Okay, so anyway, no animals were harmed in the production of this talk. And I just want to thank you all for coming. So thank you very much for being here. Thank you.